must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. Well, today is episode number 253, Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm very pleased to announce that this week's show is called Stewardship. Tune in and hear Steve share his thoughts. When you live a life of putting others first, you will experience a sense of fulfillment. You will be living a purposeful life. Well, I'm excited about doing today's show. One of my friends that's been following the last five or six episodes closely and discussing them with me, he asked me, why don't you talk about stewardship, Steve? I'd like to hear you talk about stewardship. Well, I feel that I have a pretty good grip on what stewardship is, but I did my normal research, and I want to lead in with this. In the words of John F. Kennedy at his inaugural address in 1961, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. What was so wonderful about that was I was 10 years old, nine and a half actually. And when he gave his inaugural address, those words meant so much to me. And you know, it said that he challenged every American to contribute in some way to the public good. And as a young child, that theme has stuck with me my whole life, and it has encouraged me to think about others. And, you know, I don't know that in today's political climate and the way the world is right now, if people are paying much attention to any one person's speech, but when John Kennedy said that influenced my life. I've always wanted to do for others. Sometimes I haven't, of course. I'm sure all of us have. Sometimes we haven't done anything but think about ourselves. And in this series of shows that we're doing, this is the sixth episode when I'm just trying to speak on some different subjects to encourage people in ways to have a better life. I've mentioned greatly that there's studies prove that you can have more joy in your life when you think more and do more for others. Now, stewardship, a lot of people think that it's strictly a biblical term. And hey, I guess it might have started there. You know, I'm always saying that where do we learn, you know, right from wrong, you know, what is good? The Bible is my best source. But when we go to the biblical definition of stewardship, I think it means that we're supposed to be caretaker of God's kingdom. In Peter, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 through 11, it says, as each has received a gift, employ it in serving one another as good managers of the grace of God in its various forms. You know, that's a pretty good starting point to talk about what stewardship is. It's utilizing and managing all the resources that God has provided us for his glory and for the betterment of his creation. You know, Jesus himself was a servant. You know, stewardship is that when we are servants, it's kind of the act of being a servant and taking care of resources, the resources that we've been entrusted with. In Matthew 20:28, it says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Now, let's think about it for a second here. How many of us, when we are doing for others, we feel pretty good about ourselves? We don't feel so selfish versus how many of us, when we are asked to do for others, we've got too much going on to where we can't stop what we're doing for ourselves to do something for someone else? You don't have to answer that question. I just want to talk for a few minutes about my own life and some of my own experiences. I did an episode a number of years ago. Actually, this one was episode 203, and it was titled Always Do for Others. And in there, I told a little story that I'll share again right now. I had dropped out of college. I had hitchhiked. I traveled with my friend Jack all the way out to Colorado. Then I left him in Colorado, and I continued in my journey, and I hitchhiked out to California. And when I got out there, I had a good time for a while in California. One of the expressions that I picked up that they said was the California way was what goes around comes around. And it pretty much was taught to me to mean, hey, you know, what you do for others, it'll come back to you. And that poses the question, do you do for others so that it will come back for you? Or do you do for others because that's just the right thing to do? And if you do that, it'll come back to you. It almost sounds like splitting hairs. So don't feel guilty if a lot of times you do good things with the knowledge that I know I'll be taken care of too. You know what? When you put others first and don't worry about yourself, it's amazing how things will happen to you from others, their actions that benefit you. And I don't think you need to get too intense on thinking about, do I do what I do for others because I know it's going to benefit me? If you just do for others, it will benefit you. That's an absolute guarantee. Now, I want to go back to when I was in California there. I ended up, I needed to cut my trip short, and I needed to come back to Virginia and have a surgery. And so I came home, and when I got home, I didn't have a job. I didn't have money. I slept on my mother's couch, and I had had a job working in Richmond for a company called Jack Detcherville and Sons. They made drapers and slip covers. They had about, I don't know, maybe 16, 20 people in a, what you call a sweatshop, people back there, you know, seamstresses doing a lot of sewing. And we'd had Blue Cross Blue Shield. And this was in 1974, maybe. Yeah, 1974. It's been a while ago, pushing 50 years in another 2 years. So that means it was 48 years ago. Well, here's the thing. Insurance then, Blue Cross Blue Shield, full medical coverage with a low deductible, was $33 a month. Oh, my gosh, $33 a month. Well, so when I got back, I called Jack up, Jack Detcherville, and I said, hey, I've cut my trip short. And is there any way that I can get back on the company insurance because I need a surgery? He said, here, let me give you the number for the Blue Cross Blue Shield representative. So I called him, and I talked to this wonderful, wonderful woman, and I explained my situation. And she said, well, we're sorry, but that if you've let your coverage lapse for more than 2 months, you can't get back on. We only let you come back on if you've only been off for 2 months. But you know, at the end of that conversation, she said, we're going to let you back on. And that's just what I'm always trying to say in all these conversations that I'm having with you. If you communicate and be truthful and honest, there are so many people out there that will do everything they can within their authority level of their job, if that's what it is, to help you. And this is just another example of where I needed a helping hand, and there was a person out there in Blue Cross that allowed me to do that. She said, if you can pay $99, three premiums, I'll get you back on the coverage. And so so what I did was I was at home at my mom's in Norfolk, and I hitchhiked up to Washington, D.C. area, Silver Spring, Maryland, where my dad lived. And I went up there to ask him if he would loan me $100 so that I could get back on the insurance. Well, my dad and I weren't having the closest of a relationship. And just to make a long story short, without going into all the emotions of it, he said no. He gave me all of his various reasons, which I don't need to go into right now. And basically, I thanked him for the lesson that he's trying to teach me to be more responsible, take responsibility for myself. And I do remember what I said to him in the basement of his house that day. I said, Dad, I get it. I get what you're trying to teach me. You're trying to teach me that you better not count on anybody in this life. You better to just depend on yourself, because if you can't even count on your father when you're going through a really hard time, who can you count on? So I said, I get the lesson, Dad. So I said, so I'll be all right, but I just want you to know, I'm never going to come in your house again. Well, that was pretty headstrong. But I was very, very upset that my dad knew that I needed to restore my insurance. And he had the money. He just gave me reasons why he wasn't going to do it. But I did go 20 years before I went back in his house. But fast forward another 60 years. Let's see. I was 20 when I turned 50. So 30 years later, when I got my terminal illness diagnosis with multiple myeloma, my dad and I made peace, and he was there for me, and we established a beautiful friendship for the remaining years of his life, for about the next 15 years. But I hitchhiked back to Norfolk, and I'd called my mother from a payphone on the highway, and she wanted to know, well, did your dad give you the money? And I said, no, he wasn't going to help me. She was very upset. I got back to Norfolk, and when I got there, Catherine and Robert Sawyer, these beautiful Christian neighbors, five houses up the street, got there right after I got there. And they came in and they sat down and they said, Stevie, your mom called us and told us, what happened when you went to visit your father. And we're really sorry about that. And they sat down on the couch and they said, Stevie, here's $100. We want you to get that surgery that you need. And, We love you, Stevie, and we want you to get that surgery. And I was like speechless. I was just, I think I was tearful. And then Catherine took my hand and put another $100 bill in my hand and said, Stevie, here, we want you to use this to get on your feet. And all we want you to do is just help other people, just do for other people. And then we joined hands and we prayed. Well, what a fortunate experience for me to feel the love of Jesus right then and there at that age. I guess I was 23 years old. And that really made an incredible impact on my life, because, I didn't get help from my own father, but I got help from our beautiful neighbors. But what they asked me to do was just always do for others, give to others. And so I've tried to live that way. And so now that I'm doing Right Thinking Foundation, and I spend a lot of time in mentoring relationships and forming some beautiful friendships, I'm just thankful that I have this opportunity. And so for me, I have the opportunity to serve others, to do for others. And I'll be honest with you, I never worry about myself, because I know that it will always be all right. And no matter how low I am, no matter how down I get, I know that I'm going to come out of it. And that's just a confidence that I've developed in my life that has come from living life and being among other people. As I got a little bit older, I was 23, and that story that I just shared, when I was in my 30s and, first got married and was having kids in my mid-30s, sometimes it was difficult, financial hard times, just being a young father with responsibility for children. But I knew then that everything was going to be fine, even when I was going through some real tough times. And I remember that I developed a method, an attitude. I don't know what to call it, but sometimes when I was just really in a somewhat of a struggle and I couldn't concentrate, I learned to push all my work aside, get up and just go do something for others. When I was thinking about the message I was going to deliver today, and when I came to that thought, just push everything aside and quit worrying about my own problems and just go do for others. Back in those early days, I worried about my own problems, but I don't anymore. I know that the Lord's going to take care of me and that I'm going to accept whatever it is that happens anyway. So, I don't need to worry. No need to fret. But when I was thinking about today's message, My good friend Don Green, the executive director of the Napoleon Hill Foundation, I think the most beautiful thing that I've ever learned about him is that he tells me that right next to his bed, he has this little plaque, and it's basically just a prayer that he wrote down saying, you know, "Dear Lord, show me someone that I can help today." And so that's his whole life. It's just every day he gets up, and the first thing that he asks the Lord to do is show him someone that he can go help. As we go through the different stages of our lives and we take on more responsibility and we have more pressures and stresses in life, a lot of those, though, are because the more responsibility we take on for other people, particularly our children, our spouse, our parents as they get elderly. You know, it's a blessing to be in a life where the most important thing in life is to do for others, to be there for others. And, you know, it's out of love. That's really what I've been trying to say through this whole message is that when you do it for the right reason, and the right reason is because it's love that you want to do for others because of love that you have, then you're going to just be part of God's kingdom and it will come back to you. And, as I was going into this message, I was thinking about times in my life where I was around people that did for others. And, when I was working at Harrison's Pier, one of the owners, his name was Jimmy Harrison. He was a man that I greatly admire and respect for many reasons. He was a good family man. He was a fair boss. He was a national collegiate wrestling champion. He was just a fine man. And they had these toilets there. I've told the toilet story a couple of times in some of my shows, but I'm using it differently today. So there was a men's toilet in the fishing pier and a female's toilet. We called them heads. And they needed to be cleaned out, and they got real nasty. And so the point was, one day he came out with a little toilet brush and a bottle of, you know, Clorox or whatever it was. And I said, "What are you doing?" And he goes, "I'm going to go in and, you know, clean the toilet. So there's an accident in there. I got to go clean it up." And I said, "Well, why don't you just tell one of us to do it?" One of us was, you know, the workers, you know, drove a Jeep pushing boats out and doing other things. And he said to me, "I will never ask someone to do that." And I said, "Well, if you won't ask us to do it, can I volunteer to do it? I'll let you pay me." And so I made more money, which was great. But that's one of the best examples that I can offer you of a person that's exercising great stewardship. And I want to read you a definition now that I came across. There's a gentleman that started a new philosophy that he's given credit in the 70s, in the 1970s. His name is Robert K. Greenleaf. And the phrase that he coined was servant leadership. It's a leadership philosophy in which the goal of the leader is to serve. And this was different from traditional leadership, where the leader's main focus is the thriving of a company or an organization. A servant leader shares power, puts the needs of the employees first, and helps people develop and perform as highly as possible. Instead of the people working to serve the leader exists to serve the people. And here's what I really like. This is the question that he asked people to focus on. Do those served grow as persons? Do they, while being served, become healthier, wiser, freer, more autonomous, more likely themselves to become servants? When leaders shift their mindset and they serve first, they benefit as well as their employees, and that their employees acquire personal growth. And that helps the organization grow, as well as the employees' commitment to continue to serve. This leadership style has been used in numerous organizations across the country. And it really highlights something really good here. And that is that a true leader has to serve. That's really what the point is that a leader that's not a servant is not a good leader. Now, we've all heard many, many stories about war stories where like the platoon leader, he doesn't just tell his men to go charge. He leads the charge. And I've been teaching karate at the Norfolk YMCA for, it'll be 50 years next June. I started in 1972. And I developed a trademark style that a lot of karate teachers, they drill their students. They balk out commands. They tell them what to do and stuff. But my trademark is that I have worked out with my students, gone through the same workout that I'm teaching every single one of my classes for almost 50 years. And unless I had an injury or something and I had to sit in a chair and talk to them and teach them, you know, from a not participatory place. But no, my trademark has been I work out. Now, that's about as good an example as I can give you of what I'm going to tell you next. I have found that in all of my relationships where I'm in a mentoring relationship, that I thank those that I'm mentoring for allowing me to be involved in this relationship, because I want them to know that I'm getting probably more, at least as much, but probably more out of this relationship than you are. Now, one of the reasons that I express that is because a lot of people that are being mentored, they have low self-esteem. They feel like they've got it wrong. They don't know how they're going to get it right. They feel like they're missing something, and they're trying real hard to get more so that they can have a better life. A lot of people have accepted, they brought a lot on themselves, and it's time they turn their lives around, but they don't know how. And that's one of the reasons why they enter into a mentoring, being mentored relationship. Well, they're not inferior is what I'm trying to tell them. And you know, you've heard the expression, it's better to give than to receive. Well, let me say this. If you're on the receiving end, like if you're someone in a relationship that has been, if you're the mentor, I'm the mentor. What do you want to do? I'm not an intellectual here. If I'm the one mentoring someone else and they're the one being mentored, then I'm the giver and they're the receiver. Except for this, they are allowing me to do something that I do that gives me purpose, that makes me feel worthwhile. So when I'm allowed to share some of the things that I have to give to someone who needs to receive them, they are in essence giving to me. They're giving me the opportunity to do something that I do that the Lord has given me, one of my gifts that I am now using to help someone else. So I'm going to unwrap that one for you one more time. Even though it looks like I'm the one that's giving, I'm receiving. I'm receiving the kindness of another person that is accepting what I have to give. And that's wonderful. I just love being in a life where it's a give and take like that, where you do something for someone, but you're getting something back in return. So I just want you to remember, I've encouraged everyone that is going through struggles and hardship that know they need to have someone that can help them understand things that they may not be understanding of, or be able to learn something they don't know how to do, to get a teacher, a mentor. But the best types of mentors are friends, ones that become your friends, not just a straight teacher relationship. And as you go into the relationships of the mentoring relationship, as you go further and further and you develop respect for one another and become closer friends and you see the results of the relationship, it makes me a better person when I teach classes to my karate students. It makes me a better karate person. I become more natural. I become more proficient in my techniques. I understand my own techniques better. It enables me to teach better the next time I teach. When I am mentoring someone and I have a chance to reflect on my own life and share some of my experiences, my successes and my failures, that gives me a chance to do a better job of what I'm going to share. And when I'm being mentored by people that mentor me, I become a better listener and I become more appreciative. Well, you know, we're talking about a lot of things here, but one of the main things that I'm really trying to say here is that, what are we here for? You know, I did that thing, you know, what's it all about, Alfie, about five shows ago. I've been exploring the same topic. I got 253 shows as of this show, and every one of them is really probing the exact same things. We can go back to Maslow's hierarchy of needs, what we have to have taken care of before we can get to the higher levels and the steps that we need to go up to become self-actualized. We all have to have food, shelter, clothing, warmth. If we don't have our basic needs met, we're not going to be in much of a position to give to others. And if we're not giving to others, doing for others, we don't feel so worthwhile. We ultimately could feel like, I can't even take care of myself. Or, you know, that's, you know, my life is very limited. I have a hard time, you know, I'm in a struggle and I don't have time to do anything. Well, what you're going to learn when you start to mature is that when you do for others, others are going to take care of you also. And when you do it out of a spirit of love and kindness, it's the best way to do it. And so, you know, that's how Jesus did it. And I think the most memorable story that I can offer you, I'm not sure where it is in the Bible, but when Jesus washed his disciples' feet, when he showed that he was truly a servant, at the time that was like, oh my gosh, only the lowest rung of people that were the house servants were given the task of, you know, washing someone's feet. But Jesus did it. Jesus did it. And, you know, all I can tell you is that if you're going to be a leader of your household, lead, you know, of your family, a leader of any kind of responsibility, like a work environment, if you're in the military and you're a leader, you have got to understand that the people that you are leading need to have a respect for you. They need to admire you for the person that you are. And they are not going to admire you if you are a harsh, mean, cruel taskmaster type person. There's a simple expression that I learned as a kid. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You know, a little bit of sugar goes a long way when you're trying to, you know, lead a horse there. Try getting behind a mule and putting your shoulder on a mule's backside and push as hard as you can. Yeah, let me know how it feels when you get kicked like that. I was traveling on a trip years ago, and it was when I was in the travel business, and they had a thing called FamTrip where the airlines and hotel organizations made it real easy for us to travel to distant, faraway places. Airlines pretty much gave you the plane ticket for free, and you just had to pay some taxes on it. And the hotels usually gave you like an incredible couple nights in a hotel for next to nothing. And so I went on a trip to let's see where that trip was that I'm thinking. It was to Spain. And yeah. And so we traveled and we were on a bus, and there was this tour guide that was with us on the bus. And she was Spanish speaking and she spoke good English too. And I had jet lag, and I remember I was riding this bus for a number of hours, and I had a Bible with me that had Spanish on one page and the English on the other. So it was back and forth. And I read that, and I read it for a long time. And I turned to it's Matthew chapter 7, verse 12. It's called the Golden Rule. And here's two different versions of it, so to speak. So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. And basically, simply said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So, you know, just be kind to others if that's how you want to be treated. And I can't imagine that you want to be treated any way other than kind. But I don't have the whole translation here in front of me. But I just remember that I learned it in Spanish. And I actually learned several verses of it. And in the morning, when the tour guide said good morning, all night bus ride kind of thing, I recited the Golden Rule in Spanish for her. And it brought tears to her eyes. Now, my Spanish is not practiced right now, and it's not good, but this is the short version of it. La regla de oro. Trata a los demás de la manera que te gustaría que te trataran a ti. And then I think the end of it was, esta es la regla y la ley. This is the law. You know, we get it from the Bible to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If we learn to handle ourselves in a way that we provide love, kindness, and all of our leadership roles, will be much more respected. When we enter into any relationship where we are going to be responsible for leading people, leading by example is the only way to go. And, you know, I'll go back to a very, very simple definition of what stewardship is to kind of sum this up right now. Stewardship is an ethic that embodies the responsible planning and management of resources. The concepts of stewardship can be applied to the environment, nature, economics, health, property, information, theology, cultural resources, many other things. In our offices and our duties and our obligations of a steward, it's the conducting, the supervising, or the managing of something. The careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. Stewardship of natural resources is an example. So what I'm trying to say is that when we practice good stewardship, one of the simplest things that I can tell you is good stewardship is stewardship of our finances, handling our money properly, stewardship of this planet, taking care of this planet so that it will be there for future generations. Stewardship is a beautiful concept, but to sum it up, I think that stewardship and leadership go completely hand in hand. I have several friends, probably five or six that I can think off the top of my head, that are John Maxwell leadership coaches. And John Maxwell is a incredible person who teaches leadership, some of the best leadership lessons in the world. He has a thing called the 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. And in there, he teaches servant leadership inside his law of addition. And this is his quote: "The best place for a leader isn't always the top position. It isn't the most prominent or powerful place. It's the place where he or she can serve the best and add the most value to other people." End quote. You know, in summary for today's show, I think we all want a better life, not just for ourselves, but for those that we care about, for those that we love. And for some of us, we care about everybody. We love everybody. And so there's no one that we can't try to help, to do something that we can, to intervene if we can, to help someone do better, to pick up someone. And you know, all I can say is that if you're fortunate and blessed like I am to have other people pick you up, and I've been picked up a lot of times from a lot of just absolutely wonderful people. I just told you about Catherine and Robert Sawyer. I have many, many more experiences in my life of Catherine's and Robert's in my life, but I'm appreciative and I want to give something back. And I thank all of you right now for listening to this episode today. We're right on the week of Christmas. Christmas Eve will be this coming Friday. And so I just want to say to each one of you, God bless you. And I just want to say Christmas is a wonderful time of the year, and the true meaning of Christmas and knowing that God sent his only son down here to die on that cross for us because mankind had just strayed so far that God finally had to send his own son down here to walk the earth so that we could see what it truly looks like to walk in love. And then for him to go to that cross and to die on there for our sins to bring us back to the Father. That's the purpose of why God sent his son down here. The true meaning of Christmas is that it's the birth of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Well, I just want each one of you to just love one another and serve one another. And just be thankful that we live in this wonderful country and that we have the opportunities that we do to grow and be there for others. Merry Christmas. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.